Good morning. Welcome everyone. And thank you for joining us. I'm sure it's going to be a very interesting talk with Pedro. I'm Joan Busquets, and I want to begin to acknowledge that the Harvard Graduate School of Design is located on the traditional and ancestral land of Massachusetts. The original inhabitant of what is known as Boston and Cambridge. And we pay a lot of respect to the people of the Massachusetts tribe, past, present, and future, and honor the land itself, which remains sacred to the Massachusetts people. The school also recognized the work of the Harvard University Native American Program in cultivating the relationship that led to the creation of this acknowledgement. Just a quick reminder that we have live caption available for our virtual audience that enable captions. If you want, click the closed captioning icon at the bottom of the live stream window. For our in-person audience, live captioning is available at the link of QR code currently on the screen. I think there are several reminders about the new incoming events, in March 28th, Mario Carpo is going to present a discussion on the presence of John Hedyut. In March 29th, Joel Sanders will be in a noontime lecture like the one that we have now, having a very interesting discussion about the inclusive design. All this is always available with the website and the system that we always know. Let me introduce Pedro Gadaño. He's an architect, curator, and author. I like to stress the idea of curator because I think this is very important in the way that he's going to present and going to discuss the things. Curator is somebody that makes from nothing existing, it makes something out of it. In a certain way, it's very much like a design project. Nothing exists, and suddenly the curator makes an exhibit of something that looks impossible. He was the 2020 Love Fellow from Harvard University, and Gadaño holds MA in Art and Architecture, and a PhD in Architecture and Mass Media. From 2012 to 2016, he was the curator of the contemporary architecture at the Museum of Modern Art in New York, where he coordinated the Young Architects Program and curated exhibits such as 9+1 Ways of Being Political, very important exhibit, and Even Growth, that he's going to talk about that, and a Japanese constellation. Between 2015 and 2019, he was founding director of MAAT, a Museum of Art and Architecture and Technology, very important in Lisbon, in the area near Belém, which I think has been a possibility of initiating 50 exhibition projects, including shows and publications such as Utopia versus Dystopia, Tension versus Conflicts, and Eco Visionaries. During 2021, he led a bid for a European Capital of Culture 2027 by a coalition of 70 small cities in Portugal interior. I think that's a very important initiative, and I think Pedro is going to explain about that because I think it's quite unique to imagine that you can organize an initiative of this type. Thank you, Pedro. He has edited Beyond Book Magazine, Shrapnel Contemporary Blog, and contributes regularly to international publications. He wrote Arquitectura en Público, a recipient of the FAD Prize for Thought and Criticism in 2012. And in 2022, just a couple of years ago, he launched a book titled Climate Change, How Architecture Must Transform in the Age of the Ecological Emergency, which is published by ACTAR, that has the headquarters in Barcelona and New York. We have then a very rich profile in architecture and media and art in the person of Pedro. And I think he's addressing this question of the climate change and the ecological emergency that we will be covered by his presentation today. Please join me in welcoming Pedro Gadaño to the floor. Thank you.
Thank you, Juan, for the presentation. So kind. And thank you, Anne, for inviting me for this cycle of the Urban and Planning Design Department. And I want to start by saying that I've changed the title of the conference. So although it is about priorities and how they can reverse across your life, I thought it was maybe more relevant to speak about this idea of shifting politics, like shifting gears, shifting the political commitments that you assume through the practice of design, both architectural design and urban design. And so there is a story here that goes from architecture to objects and then back to the urban realm and even urban regions, which is also a story of changing your political stance in regards to what is happening around you. And precisely, the story starts today around this exhibition that I made at MoMA in 2012 when I was assigned the role of curator of contemporary architecture at the museum, in which when I was asked by Barry Bergdahl to do my first show on the MoMA collection, the architecture and design collection, but also the broader collection of the museum, I was sort of listening to people around me just after the Occupying Wall Street events, asking precisely what could architecture contribute, what could architecture do in face of the situation we're living, shortly after the 2008 crisis, financial crisis. And for me, the answer was obviously that architecture was inherently political. If we're talking about the polis, we are talking about politics. If we're talking about the city, if we are inserting ourselves into the space of the city, we are inevitably assuming political positions, whether we acknowledge them or not, whether we recognize them and engage with them or not. And this is what the exhibition was really about, looking at 50 years of production through the lens of the MoMA collection to envisage what kinds of political attitudes you could discover in those objects, in those archival moments of projects done since the 1960s. And in fact, what I thought was interesting was the reaction that came up shortly after the exhibition. And I remember someone telling me that Stan Allen had mentioned, so now everything is political. And I thought it was interesting that there was a sort of attempt to control from certain circles what could be considered political or not. And of course, I was much more expansive in considering that all types of works could indeed have a political message. And I'm not going into the contents of the exhibition, but I can tell you that also I took the opportunity to, of course, engage with the work of artists that would also comment on architecture and urban interventions and would bring a sort of critical light onto the activities of architects. And this for me is very important and runs through what I want to present here today. This idea that we are trying constantly to question and to project a critical light on our own activity or on the activity of our disciplinary field. And so in this case, the work of artists was truly important from Ai Weiwei to Dan Graham to really look back at some of the architecture and urban design's contributions toward half a century and to have different perspectives, different readings that normally architects were shy to produce on their own work. For instance, the work of Dan Graham was not only important because of his perspectives on the tract house, creating these transparency layers that would question the idea of transparency and privacy in the modern movement, but they were also considerably important when he brought also his theoretical thinking onto the reading of the works of Mies van der Rohe, for instance. And that is actually the kind of readings that you see not so often in the world of architecture, inward as that world tends to be. So in a way, for me, curating was also already and always a possibility to expand beyond the field and to have a look from the outside into the inside of our discipline. But there was also this inherent desire to produce other sorts of political statements. And even growth, which was part of the issues series, was an exhibition that truly addressed the one political issue that I continues to transverse all of our contemporary reality, which is the question of inequality. So that is inequality that you can express through lines of race, gender, and so many others. And of course, class and economics. And this show produced precisely a perspective on how urban megacities were places of inequality and were places where inequality, after many decades during the 20th century, in which it appeared that we were correcting those inequalities, and in fact, many people were taken out of poverty. The bigger urban structures around the planet were places where inequality thrived and continues to thrive. And so this was really an exhibition that tended to address how architects somehow could address those issues and put them in the center stage rather than just having them as some side issue. And so what we did was actually engaging local practices that worked together with more international practices that brought a sort of external light onto the perspective on such cities. We picked cities in every continent, and those practices would then look at what were considered the expressions of inequality within those urban cities. And I can give you as an example the work that was made around Istanbul that got together a young practice called Superpool from the city, and the Atelier des Architectures Autogérées from Paris, which by working together and by creating these forced marriages actually led into something that I think the original groups couldn't produce by themselves. So this is where curating also has a function in creating certain conditions for some chemistry to happen and for certain innovations to happen when you get people together that probably haven't known each other before or that are coming from different fields or different backgrounds, and you let them to produce some thinking about topics that are being considered. And so in this case, for instance, because Superpool were much engaged with social media and the function of social media, and Atelier des Architectures Autogérées were looking at agricultural production in urban contexts, and also the economics of the suburbs in Paris and how people actually thrived in those areas, they came back with a solution, with an idea of an app that would allow people to exchange services in areas, suburbia, that were devoid of any urban functions like commerce services and that were only using habitation, housing, and lacked that sort of social exchange. That kind of app you maybe wouldn't call it a design tool, a traditional design tool, but it was actually an extremely interesting response to the possibilities emerging to recreate urban life in that site. And so that means that sometimes results wouldn't be necessarily architectural or urbanistic, but they would pick on these possibilities of exchanging different languages to produce other responses. After I left MoMA and coming back to Lisbon, I had the opportunity to test out what for me was an opportunity to get different views from the worlds of art and architecture together, commenting on each other, and therefore, again, trying to produce exchanges, knowledge exchanges that would shed some different lights on how we act in the cities and how we produce space. And so here again, there was this contrast between works made like Ram Kula's or Ozaki in after the Second World War, but also works of artists that consider how we were potentially shifting from 500 years of utopia to a moment that we could call more dystopian. For me, the trigger for that idea actually came from reading the word dystopian in the New York Times more frequently after I came to New York, and considering that this was bewildering because dystopia was a term that I knew from science fiction as a sort of negative utopia, and the fact that this negative utopia was invading reality and transforming our reality was indeed quite disturbing. And that led to this idea and this research to investigate if we were actually moving from that realm of utopia into a more dystopian context. Remember that at this time, Trump was also winning his election, and populist movements were sort of arising around the world, especially in Europe, but also other places. And we were indeed moving into territories that seemed inexplicable and unexpected. And indeed, artists generally are those who have these sort of sensors that can identify these situations and reflect upon them and present you work that then really creates some critical perspective, some different critical perspective on what you normally see out of these issues. And so at that time, one of the commissions that we did was already concerned with what I was considering more and more the other emergent political problem of our times, connected to inequality, intersecting it, and many times, of course, intertwining with it, which is the question of the ecological emergency. And this commission was the commission to a Portuguese artist to produce a reflection on this idea of dystopia. And what he picked was super interesting. It was actually a fake news that came out in a British newspaper that was telling the story that the Beijing government had started projecting the sunset in Tiananmen Square because of the pollution that wouldn't allow you anymore to see the sunsets. And this was a fake story created by a journalist as a sort of a critical fiction. And the artist decided to enact and to build that billboard. And so he actually sort of created that alternative future by creating that billboard in the museum that would show you this artificial sunset complete with information about how temperatures were rising, the levels of pollution, and so on and so on. And so in a way, he sort of anticipated what could be coming out of a fiction. And this connects certainly to the last aspects that I'm discussing here today in terms of scenario thinking and its importance for us to conceive not only possible futures, but also to throw, again, a critical light on our own practice. So the next exhibition I made there was perhaps the most important I consider I did in my life. And essentially because it really transformed the way I was looking at the world. This was an idea that was coming up at that time. And as you see in the title, Eco-Visionaries, it was still quite positive and optimist when I started the project. So there was the idea that through design, maybe we could reverse some of the problems that we also had created through design along the last two or three centuries. And therefore, this was an investigation on how we not only were creating from the fields of art and architecture potentially more awareness about the ecological emergency, but also how to deal with it and how to start producing or devising actions that would deal with that context. This was 2016, so not that far ago. And this is also where I can explain what I understand by climate agnosticism. Because at this point, before I started my research for the exhibition, I could be considered, like many of us, a climate agnostic. I neither gave it too much importance, nor did I oppose it. I believed in it, but at the same time, I was not so committed to deal with it. And I think this is what's still happening with most of the people, because it is indeed, like scientists call it, a wicked problem. One of those problems that is very difficult to not only embrace, but also to understand really deep, in a deep manner, and to in a way that may start as want to act on it. And so this exhibition was, again, a very ambitious exhibition. It was a collaboration in between five museums in Europe with the idea that it would really spread the message across a large number of geographies. It was not intended as a tour exhibition, also because of environmental issues, but it was intended as a project, a curatorial project that would emerge in each museum as a different version, local version, of the bigger exhibition. So in total, it would bring together more than 80 artists, but never 80 artists were shown together in one venue. But it was shown in Lisbon, and then in Switzerland, in Spain, and then finally in the UK. But coming back to my research and to the importance of that research, what happened was that typically as a curator, I would dive into the subject for the previous 6 months before starting the planning and the production of the exhibition. And those 6 months meant that I read everything that came my way about the ecological emergency. And this was very different from, as we mostly do, hearing about the effects of climate change over the course of our life. One day it's a news about the polar bear in the ice. The other day is temperature is growing. By the end of the year, the hottest year on record. And then another one, and then another one. And these facts just multiply, like creating a certain numbness and creating also a sort of diluted level of information, which is very different from reading about only that subject for 6 months and realizing the depth and the, and let's say, the horror of the situation in which we are. But of course, we don't want to also and exclusively dwell in eco-anxiety. We must find positive ways to answer and to react and to produce thinking, positive thinking, and even innovation about the subject. And this is also what the exhibition intended, albeit, of course, already in a sort of state of schizophrenia in between pessimism and optimism. So there was one section about disaster that would look at mostly at what the extraction of fossil fuels was causing in terms of changes in our atmosphere, what we all now know as a sort of common knowledge. But there were also a section on coexistence and how we were in the design and art field starting to address this idea of coexistence with other species and how to design for those other species and how to integrate that thinking into our own designs that were up till now completely centered in our own humanity. But then there was, of course, the problem of extinction and the fact that we are going through the sixth mass extinction and that we are in the middle of something provoked by humanity that is driving us to a situation in which we will eventually suffer the consequences through famine and through other problems derived from the lack of biodiversity. And finally, the exhibition ended in a sort of positive tone with the idea of adaptation, not mitigation, but adaptation. What some say becomes the necessary alternative when mitigation is no longer working and we do not attain the levels or the goals of decarbonization that we are working with, and therefore we must think about adaptation. And here was actually the section where most designers and architects came up, because of course we still believe we can change the world. We still believe we can design our way out of the problems that humanity has created over the last centuries. And the exhibition ended with this dual image, this kind of dual scenario or possibilities. On one side, you had a work from an African artist that represented these tribes of young kids in African cities that lived by collecting the detritus of our civilization and decorating themselves with these detritus and creating some new civilizational paradigm. And on the other side, the work of Anthony Dune and Rabi, which looks at objects that might help us adapt to new conditions. In this case, these are sort of machines that people could adapt or use as a way to digest grass, which, as you know, we can't, as cows can, and therefore to make us able to forest and to eat other kinds of food, and using, of course, a sort of cynical or ironical technical optimism. That is, of course, the other side and the other version of the idea that actually came up in the Venice Biennial, but then was sort of subdued, which is Africa is the future, indeed, but not for the reasons we expected. And so there was this duality that was left by the end. And there was also, of course, the book made about it, and the exhibition then came up in Madrid with quite a lot of success, but also at the Royal Academy in London, where I had high expectations for it in terms of projecting, of course, this message to bigger audiences, namely because, of course, if you're presenting at the Royal Academy in London, then you have a global audience projected through the media, which, of course, will also expand that message. But at the same time, there was something of a disappointment coming up with the ability of exhibitions to actually produce that sort of transformation or that shift in terms of change in the condition we were. I mean, of course, it requires other more important and more expanded political action to actually produce the kind of change we need for this moment. At the same time we did this exhibition, some of the commissions we made at the larger hall of the museum were made with international artists that responded to that space. And in this case, Japanese artist Tadashi Kawamata, for the first time worked with plastic garbage waste that appeared on the beaches around Lisbon. So This was a 1,000 square meter installation in which the garbage collected on the beaches around Lisbon across just 30 days were collected and exhibited as this sort of wave coming from the traditional Japanese depictions of the sea, in which you really saw something quite terrible, quite a punch on the stomach when you come up over the museum, because this space you come up from above and then you enter into the space from the inside. And then you had this kind of poetic atmosphere created by these sunken ships and these the light crossing through the garbage. What was important for me about this installation was the fact that suddenly schools of children were coming in and visiting this installation and getting an awareness of the problems they were involved in. There was also a documentary about the making of the piece. And this was obviously a way to try and create that impact in audiences that I felt was needed in order to address the scope and the magnitude of this problem. And of course, this was an image that came up later, but that sort of reflected what for me had happened in terms of the current situation. Perhaps some of you have already come across this metaphor of the frog in the boiling water, in which basically, if you turn the temperature slowly, the frog won't jump and it will let itself die. And this is what's happening with us and the ecological emergency. That's what I realized through the making of these exhibitions. And for me, what had happened that made me shift my political position was precisely the fact that I had jumped over those 6 months into the hot water and jumped immediately out and considered that this was the line of work that I had to do for the rest of my life. I mean, there was no other political matter that was so substantial and so relevant other than this. And I must say, this decision was a difficult one to take because it does imply that, like for instance, in a country like the one where I am, where no political action is being taken or practical action is being taken on climate change and the ecological emergency, I'm basically doing nothing. I'm taking care of my farm, taking care of the biodiversity in the farm, because there are no think tanks, no study groups, nothing where you can actually contribute with your knowledge. And this is, of course, painful and striking, but at the same time, you know, once you have this change into a sort of ecological activism, actually you cannot go back, you cannot step back, you cannot change. At the same time, at that time, I was realizing that as the publication of the Center, Canadian Center for Architecture at explored at that time, the museum was not enough. The museum is not enough. So there is not one realm that is enough to address this problem and to actually engage in whatever forms of ecological activism you can within your own areas or within the fields that are available or possible for you. And this is where I want to discuss the idea of ecological activism. I mean, I don't condemn these sort of situations, but I do realize that they are sometimes not very effective, because although they are media savvy and they get attention, they also create a sort of revolt in people and a misunderstanding of why these young people are doing this. But of course, these people are just responding to their own eco-anxiety by doing actions that they think will be enough to call attention. But the type of ecological activism that I defend and that I would put forward at this moment is of a different nature. It really relates to the fact that you can do only what you can do from within your own field of knowledge. And believe me, in each field of knowledge, you can respond to the situation. and you can engage with a sort of political activism that tries to respond to the situation. But you really have to, in a way, be committed to it and have it as central in your discourse and not just a sort of side issue again that comes up because you have to respond to certain certification needs or to just the need to respond to the current discourse trend. No, this is much more important than that. It must be core to your action as a designer, as a student, as a professional, as a practitioner. And that's why when I left the museum and I had the privilege and the opportunity to do the Loeb Fellowship here, I thought I could turn this opportunity into a sort of self-tailored course on climate change and everything related. And that's what I did during my Loeb year. I took classes in every school, from the Kennedy School to the Arts and Science, to the GSD, and others, on every class that was actually discussing issues of environmental problems, environmental action, climate justice, science on climate change, and everything. And that was, again, my second punch on the stomach, the fact that I had access to all these scientists, all these political scientists and environmental economists and everybody that was at Harvard discussing this subject. And of course, if I hadn't done that sort of dive again into that those different fields of knowledge, I would have never had the ability or the possibility to actually produce the reflection that came up in this book, which I see again as an object of activism. So my form of activism is actually not throwing the paint at the, at these works of art, but is actually to produce in whatever field of action I can to produce statements that might have some impact or some importance. And for me, the book was also a way of sort of getting that knowledge together and have it thrown a light on architectural history, on architectural criticism today, on architectural theory today, on architectural practice. Actually, as an architect, I was always very interested in history and theory, and I had always produced quite a lot of critical reflection on our ways of practice. And this was also an opportunity to look at practice, how we had it, and how we have it still, and how this could actually be changed. So the book contains a lot of going back into questions such as why did the first environmental avant-garde in the 70s fail? And goes into the analysis of what were the conditions that actually didn't allow these people to thrive and to become relevant within the architectural field, including the fact that there is a mainstream discourse that keeps its legitimacy very well guarded, not allowing some alternative discourses to, let's say, disturb its own narrative. And so this was for me very important to go deep into that, and I came from a school that is part of that core, the Oporto School, together with the GSD and many others that certainly have a role in guarding that discourse in a positive aspect as well. But I knew very well what the matter was in that respect. And this idea of the autonomy of practice, that was really what had to be disturbed in order for this subject to become relevant and to have an importance, which was similar to the kind of change that we had in the early 20th century with the introduction of the modern movement. Let's realize that that movement was introduced over a course of 20, 30 years through very clever propaganda from people like Corbusier and Mies van der Rohe, but they actually managed to change practice in 20 years from what we knew as the sort of eclectic practice of the 19th century into what we know as the modern tradition. And what I advocate is that that kind of change is again possible if we are committed to it. But it's also necessary. And so that's why the second chapter of the book really looks into the difficulty of starting to change. What are the conditions that prevent us to start that change? And those conditions are as simple as having practices that are embedded in the market that is not yet prepared to accommodate certain needs and certain priorities, and therefore being very difficult to introduce that logic into our everyday work. But of course, there were others, and I invite you to go into the book to find those other reasons, but basically all of these would have to deal with this massive transformation that some say will be akin, if not bigger, than that transition from the industrial period to what we consider modernity. And so that transition, of course, that's what we're dealing politically with every day, and what you read about in politics, with the fact that it gets reversed more or less every day. We go a step forward and we move two steps back in terms of European politics, American politics, and global politics. And that's why change maybe has to start in some different areas of activity other than just politics. And so one fundamental chapter of the book looked into this idea that, going back to Aldo, that we have to conceive of buildings as part of nature, as part of something that by now is, of course, not the first nature, because nature is over, is a nature touched by humanity. But we have to consider the environment as something which is also includes the interventions of man, and we cannot distinguish our production from that of nature. And therefore, we have to see architecture enmeshed into these ecological systems, and we have to produce it as such. And that's a big shift and a big move. But I do think it's possible. And there are, of course, already the signs in practice that these changes are starting to happen. So before I go into that last chapter, I also consider that, of course, when you start reading about this subject, many scientists and many advocates of change, of course, go into this idea that before you even start your practices, of course, it's the political system that must be changed. And the political system is the political system of consumption, of the way, or the idea that growth, constant growth, is what must drive our economies. And so, of course, the idea of degrowth is coming up increasingly in discourses. And I do remember that when I introduced the topic over dinner at one of the Loeb dinners, everybody was shocked and repelled the idea, because there wasn't yet this article in the New Yorker that started to make people more amenable to discuss such a concept. And this concept is not the concept of going back in terms of ideas of progress or in terms of ideas of well-being, but in a way just reconsidering how we measure our happiness, not through GDP, but other ways of measuring that happiness that may drive us into a situation that at least allows us to manage the resources that we have to have within our global ecological system to survive. Because let's say the other aspect of changing from climate agnosticism to ecological activism is also the consideration that actually climate change may actually be a distraction, and that the real problem is really the problem of ecological balance and resources, and that the climate change may just be a symptom of something which is bigger and more difficult. And so that's why degrowth had to be discussed. And I was happy to be in a jury for the Oslo Triennale and help choose the curators that were actually proposing degrowth as a topic in architecture. And they investigated a number of practices that were already using ideas that were akin to politics of degrowth, like even using ideas of circular economy, come close already, of course, to ideas of degrowth. So that's led me to the last chapter of the book, in which actually what I thought was important was to show the readers, the audience, that actually action was possible and that it was already happening and that it had already many expressions. So unlike the shift from the 19th century to modernism, we were not looking at one particular style, one particular formal approach, but we were looking at a philosophy of action that was expressing itself in different forms, in different languages, and in different formats as well. So the examples I gave went from UN studios' use of solar panels in the facades so that they become integrated into the language of the building. But they could also be the studies or researches that big offices such as Renzo Piano and Foster were doing into ideas of self-sufficient units and the language of these self-sufficient units. But it could be also the work of SuperUse, this group in the Netherlands, that upgraded the ideas of rural studio and created systems to understand what resources were available to recycle into buildings and therefore use the nature of those materials to define the language of the designs they were proposing. Or ideas like producing vertical urban farming within the urban context, which would lead also to new architectural languages, or of course absorbing also this idea of the system of the ecosystem into the skin of buildings so as to make buildings produce energy and produce life and produce responses to their ecological surroundings. But also these very important ecological exchanges in between the developing worlds and the developed world, or if you want, the global south and the north, in terms of really producing these things where they are most needed, where the impacts of these ecological crises are being felt more acutely. And so this has to be the first thing, to exchange this knowledge that we are accumulating in these centers of production, like where we are today, so that they are brought into regions where they really are needed and where they need, as in that example I gave of the Uneven Growth exhibition, where they need to enter in dialogue with local traditions and ways of dealing with local climatic contexts. So this was really the important aspect of assuming that we were already in another time, but we were not yet responding with our design languages and our design discourses to the conditions of that time. And therefore, the urgency to start discussing these, even in terms of pedagogy, even in terms of the academic world. There is also a discussion in the book about that. And I was actually happy to see that when I was here as a Loeb Fellow, I noticed that there was an urgent request by students asking, why are we not addressing climate change in the school? Why we are not addressing the ecological crisis? And I've seen that in 2 years, because there is a sort of ability or agility of these private institutions to actually start changing their curriculum. I had seen that 2 years after, the GSD had already responded with new courses and more direction onto these areas. And so more focus in onto these areas. So I was glad to see that this was also already happening. But I would say that the speed of change still has to increase, and we still have to find the different ways in which we actually can insert these ideas into the everyday practice. And that's why this exhibition that is closing in 2 days in New York was again for me important, because being about the production of studios, emerging young studios from Portugal, where the tradition of architecture is still very based on modernist, on our modernist credo, there was also ideas of change already being adopted by these young offices. And they could be very tiny, they could be very subtle, but they would be a start of a change. And therefore, this exhibition showed how seven practices had very different ways of turning their own tradition, the tradition of Portuguese architecture, which is very context-based, very connected to site, very connected to climate conditions, to actually start inserting these themes and renovating that tradition through the scope of the ecological emergency, therefore addressing issues such as biodiversity, the importance of geology, and experiments with recycle in situ, the materials of refurbishments, finding very different ways of dealing with this aspect. So for me, the question of diversity is also always essential, in the sense that we don't need one answer, we need many different answers. And this was actually, for me, in my idea, the second exhibition of a series of exhibitions that I had proposed within that program of the European Capital of Culture, of doing architecture exhibitions in different climatic zones of Europe, and to see how those architects were responding to their different contexts in terms of adopting a logic that would respond to the ecological emergency. And the first one was in Sweden. And so the condition there, of course, is very different from Portugal as a Mediterranean country. And here the issues were about technologies of timber and introducing timber as a sustainable material, ideas of circularity, and so on and so on. But I could imagine that in each location where you would go, different traditions would lead into different responses to this ecological emergency. And the last exhibition I want to mention was actually an exhibition already after the book and the first reactions to the book, which I made with a Portuguese artist that had had this environmental concern for the last 20, 30 years. And I just made a sort of retrospective exhibition of his work related to the idea of natural resources. Because at that point, I was really concerned with the idea of resources, ideas of scarcity, and how to deal with scarcity, and how to integrate ideas of scarcity into architectural discourse. So finding other ways to, again, prolong and continue my ecological activism. That also continues in the form of writing that sometimes can be asked to be very provocative. Some students in Madrid asked me to make a contribution to a magazine edition that they were doing on the topic of the end. And so for me, it was almost inevitable to pick on the writings of Patrick O'Fools, which I was reading at the time, which for me is an amazing political ecologist writing in the late 70s and already portraying the situation that we are living right now in an amazing way, in an electrifying way, which has as the title of his last book, Electrifying the Titanic, which is this description of what we're doing right now as a society, as we focus our, you guessed it, all our bets on just electrifying the economy as a way of decarbonization. what he says is that is electrifying the Titanic. It's just, you know, putting some electric lights as the boat goes down. And that wouldn't solve, obviously, our problems. And this leads me to the option studio that I'm going to describe very quickly, that I have proposed here, which is just another of the paths for change that I'm advocating through this ecological activism. So, of course, the academic world is where the change also has to start, because these are the students that are going to start practicing already in a new condition, and they do have to be prepared to respond to that condition at the risk of being totally irrelevant. And therefore, for me, it was also important to consider how to address these issues from the point of view of, in this case, an option studio, and how to consider and bring these issues together. And so what came up was this idea of envisioning the rural metropolis as a welcoming region for climate migrants, which is attractive enough as in terms of discourse, but contains a more hidden political agenda in terms of how we're using our design tools to actually consider these problems. So the issue here, it's very simple. There's a region that is depopulating in Portugal, as in many areas in Europe, as in many areas in the States. But this is a region that actually has no reason not to be attractive. It has fantastic natural conditions. It has resources. It has water. Impacts of climate change are considered to be sort of 30 years postponed in regards to other areas which are 30, 40 kilometers away in Portugal because of its geographical condition. And yet, this area is depopulating and will be depopulating if no political vision is brought onto the area that could change its destiny and its direction. And that's what the studio is addressing. What kind of change could we envision as a sort of political strategy for the region based on different scenarios? First one is scenario of business as usual. So if we go on doing exactly what we're doing, if we are just going on with this politics of, you know, changing to renewable energies, but at the same time then not being able to deal with economic lobbies and having some goals of decarbonization, but then stepping back every time a farmer makes a protest, and so on and so on. If we go on like this, what would be the plan? What would be the shifts that we would have to introduce so as to achieve a certain potential reality by 2074, which, by the way, is the 100th anniversary of the Portuguese Revolution in 1974, but it's also the year that scientists have predicted that would be when the population of the world would plateau. So we would reach, apparently, 10 billion people in 2074, and from then on, our population will slowly start to decline, which poses the second scenario, which is managed degrowth. What if we decided that we are going to test degrowth? If we created a model to understand how degrowth would work as a political model, as an administrative model, as an economic model, what would go along with it in terms of design? And that's what we are exploring in this scenario. And then, because we have to consider it as well, the third scenario would be near collapse or collapse, because there is a risk of political collapse. There is a real risk with the peak of oil and so on to, by 2060 to 2065, that we can have a major social collapse. And therefore, how would we plan for that? And this is very interesting because it originates a kind of thinking that is very difficult for designers, which is even to consider the hypothesis of going back to the city states And how do you protect that city-state from your neighbors? And how do you create actually a condition of self-sufficiency, which is not only ecological, but also political and economical? And that drives us into thinking about subjects, which are very rare, maybe, in terms of design thinking and design discourse. Another of those authors that was referential for me and for the students was this William by William Catton, also written by the end of the 70s on the aftermath of the 1973 oil crisis, in which, again, just looking at ecological laws, he identifies what is the carrying capacity of the world, how we overpassed that carrying capacity over the last 200 years, and how did we do it, how did we manage to do it, and how, if we go on as we are inevitably hitting a wall at a certain moment in which resources are simply not enough, and therefore, as in any other ecological system, produces a massive die-off. And where I saw that the, or when I, the moment I saw the studio for me had been a success was actually the moment in which students were super concerned with realizing if that area of 40 kilometers by 20 kilometers, which as you know in normal metropolitan areas carries about 10 million people, they were actually making the calculations and really concerned about if the area could sustain 120,000 people. That's when I realized that they had made their mental shift and that they were already thinking under a different paradigm, which was what William Catton advocated at the time, which we really had to shift the way we consider our actions and our ways of dealing with any professional field, which is to really integrate this ecological thinking at the basis of our discourse and at the basis of the possibilities of our activity. So in a way, what this translated was what I call a kind of science fiction urbanism, which is based on this idea of extrapolation of current trends and then devising what would be kind of possible scenarios and just use those scenarios also as a sort of political test to what could happen over the next 30 to 40 years, but also as a critique to our own field and a sort of reading, an interpretation, a critical reading of what we're doing through other lenses, namely the lenses of the ecological emergency. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Pedro, for the so inspiring presentation. Yeah. We have some time for questions and answers. If you, yeah, please. Yeah.
Just one question. You talked about how you traverse all of the schools and looking at the kind of discussions throughout them. Did you see any consistent threads that carried across besides, of course, just the kind of anxiety and kind of things like that? But were there any strong threads between the different schools that you saw as you traversed those spaces?
Well, I haven't been in that many schools, but what I've seen mostly...
Amongst Harvard.
Okay. Yeah. Oh, yeah. No, I mean, it's very different because... But it's one important aspect of this story. It's that, you know, people in different areas are looking at their own field, and rarely are they actually exchanging knowledge in between these different fields. And I think more recently, actually, Harvard created that sort of course that is across schools and dealing with the environmental crisis. But normally, even scientists will know very well what's happening in their area, and they're sometimes not so aware of what other areas have in terms of implications for their own activity. So I don't think there are many people. I mean, there are a few here, of course, Dan Schrager, for instance. There are a few people who are very knowledgeable about the situation in different fields. But in general, you could say that people are still looking at the subject from their own islands of production of knowledge. And what I saw and what I see, and I'm still interested here, and that's probably why I came back to urbanism, is the fact that, you know, architecture is not enough as well. You cannot resolve problems at the level of the building, and you have to have the urban context in dialogue with the buildings mm-hmm. to create that sort of support system that will guarantee a certain ecological balance. And therefore, this intersection is fundamental at this point. And one thing I find super interesting here is the fact that landscape architecture is also present, and landscape architecture has a lot more information about these systems and the working of these systems that could benefit all of these interventions, also at the architectural and urban scale. And that's why in the course it's interesting that the groups are made of always someone from the background of urban design, architecture, and landscape.
Thank you. For questions, Anne, please.
This was really fascinating. Thank you very much. You mentioned that you're proposing not a style, but a philosophy of action. But historically, it's been hard to actually transfer a philosophy of action to many people. Often architects in particular have taken on the style, but maybe not the underlying philosophy of action. I wonder if you have a proposal for how to make sure that the philosophy of action is actually sort of propagated. Perhaps you could give examples of something that might be sort of that happening. In this domain?
I mean, it's difficult to conceive like that, but I don't think this idea that other than being a site, something that you have to introduce in the process of design as a plus and as a response to a given circumstance, but making it a priority, that's where the title Priorities Reverse come from. I mean, it's about shifting the center of what is the important aspect in our discourse and action. And that's why this more philosophical discussion in the center of the book, in the chapter Thinking as a Building, really goes into that idea of Aldo, of thinking like a mountain. So that if you deeply understand the ecological context, then that necessarily shifts your position and your angle and perspective. And then that starts to affect the way you want to innovate, to produce a certain linguistic response. And so the linguistic response would have to come out of that principle rather than just the reverse, which is to have a form and then to add just the need to respond to a certain circumstance to that form. I think the form has to come out of that need. And that's why sometimes with the students we talk about these hybrid programs that would originate out of different needs of producing energy, of dealing with food production, and how do these needs combine into new architectural programs that would then necessarily would have a new form or a new language.
Good. More questions?
Hi, thank you so much for the talk. Very inspiring to see the work and what it's led to over time. So you mentioned several systems, two specifically, one that is dependent on capitalism and growth and the nation state. And then you also talked about the city state, which is more focused on a circular economy and providing for immediate needs. And even within the course, the different scenarios seem to envision one or the other, even though they're in direct opposition to one another. And I was curious if you have any inclinations from the past work and explorations that you've been doing, and then also what's developing in the studio, the potential for coexistence between these systems?
I mean, it's very difficult to predict the future. So that's one issue. But what I thought was interesting, and that came up out of these studios and these reflections, was the idea that we could actually go back to models that have existed already in the history of urbanism. But this idea of the city-state or the city-region can now be, of course, with our scientific knowledge and all the information that we possess at this level, can be transformed into something novel. Because it's not only the countryside supporting the city as a, no, it's really using the metropolis as sort of diffuse and low-density metropolis across that region, but with the guarantee that you attain a certain self-sufficiency, both in terms of food production, energy production, and so on. And so I think in either scenario, and that was my interest with provoking these three different scenarios, the idea would be to what comes out that is a common denominator. That would be the interesting aspect. If students respond to different scenarios, what is the common denominator that makes sense in each of the three? Because that's probably the path that we would have to take anyway. Because we do know also from scientific knowledge, that certain things are going to happen. And therefore, it's a question of understanding how to start planning for those, even if we are using a device or an instrument that is largely fictional. But I always had this relationship to fiction, and I always liked the idea that fiction can tell you truths that sometimes facts cannot. And therefore, you can understand other things moving through the design in this case that would come from this fictional staging that otherwise, if you were being too factual, you could not devise or you could not sort of guess.
More questions? Yeah, please.
Hi, thanks for sharing. I actually wonder if like your description for like how you experienced those 6 months and leads you to where you are right now, and your collection of information along the way among different disciplines to get you here today. Is there any way our conversation within the discipline could get out and have more impact to the other fields, like, and let people in more disciplines take this action as we do have the discussion here today?
Of course, I do think that, as we were saying earlier, courses like this one that Harvard has proposed that goes across faculties and tackles all the information, it's a way of also instigating that discourse, because, as you know, that's instigating that interchange, because that will come out of dialogue, informal dialogues that are created by people. This is not something that is imposed top-down. It's something that will emerge as people start to create dialogues from across different backgrounds. And then I think that as it starts to produce results, because we haven't talked about other forms of activism that I have in mind, but like producing a startup that is addressing the need to produce energy, renewable energy, is also a form of activism that has an impact on society. So there are other positive aspects of producing that change and that impact across society that comes from other ways. But for certain, I think this is where it germinates and then can have effects across society at other moments. Not necessarily just because of cultural events, which I started to slightly disbelief, or museums or anything, but because people bring that sort of ability to interact with other areas into their professional, the way they deal with their professional career.
More questions? Yeah, please.
Hi, thank you. I think you've done a really wonderful job of threading a lot of different eras and different ideas in a really clear way, so which is difficult with these topics, so I really appreciate that. I think two things. One, just a quick comment to follow something. I teach the climate by design class here, and I have recently been engaged in there's a faculty basically dinner that happens via Salata Institute, where exactly the question someone asked, individuals from different disciplines present every week. So there's this beginning to be a kind of cross dialogue of what's happening, which is really wonderful because it does. We're all busy in our own kind of places. And so it does really begin to be a way where those things happen. And I think that's very new. The thing that I wanted to come back to and what you were talking about, which I very much agree with and is something I kind of am trying to pick up on in the climate by design class, is this idea that the climate, you know, we talk often about this kind of twin crises. We have the climate crisis and a biodiversity crisis, and I think you were hitting on the fact that really they're the same. They are emergent from the same problem. And I think that gets lost quite a lot. Mm-hmm. Or they're emergent from the same history. And I think the thing that I was thinking about is the way we then talk about adaptation versus mitigation, and so much of the adaptation becomes this kind of technological response, you know, that has its own problems in material concerns, et cetera, that perpetuate the problem. And so I was thinking as you were talking, and I'm interested to hear your thoughts on this, about, you know, if we actually begin to think about it as this, as emerging from the same kind of disconnect from ourselves and environment, that in fact adaptation of our thinking and adaptation of our behavior from an understanding of that could become mitigation in itself, that the distance between adaptation and mitigation would be much less. And yeah, and so I'm interested in kind of maybe some from your experience or the research you've done, especially on thinking about where we were in the 70s and where we are now. You know, it's like we went way off or backwards or whatever you want to call it. Yeah, so just maybe a more open question on that.
I mean, one of the reasons why those environmental avant-gardes failed was because they didn't have the technology available to actually pursue some of the ideas that they had, which persisted, but now can be pursued through those technologies. They didn't have the data collection, the sensors that we have now. In agriculture, that's very similar. You have now a potential to go back to practices that predate modernism, but with the technology and the information of our era. So you can go back to better practices, but informed by a technology that didn't exist back then. And so it's not really going backwards. It's like going forwards with a look onto practices that predated what we came to have as fossil fuel-driven technologies. And that implicates going back to certain, I mean, I'm talking about, especially in terms of food production, the fact that you can produce, restore biodiversity, mitigate, and produce food, actually sometimes even at better yields if you go back to certain models of production which are much more natural, agroforestry and so on. And we discussed this a lot with the students in this case, because the region would have to survive on that. And therefore you are bringing together different paths that are going in parallel right now, and they would be brought together for the same goal. So reforestation, agroforestry, and then designing with that in mind would all come together and would both benefit biodiversity, goals of decarbonization, and even the ability to, another topic we discuss a lot, which is the ability to bring together competitive land uses. So that's all ways in which I think we now have the information, but maybe not yet the political will to shift into those directions. They are there, and we are not taking advantage of them. Naomi Oreskes, in the beginning of her book, that she wrote this fine sentence, which I use as a quote in my book, as an initial quote, which is, how could they fail so bluntly knowing so much about this subject, right? We know so much about it, but we are failing so bluntly in terms of applying that knowledge.
Questions? No. Okay. No, then I'd like to end that, to thank you for that. And I think I'd like to take your observation that you said, well, a lot of changes are possible if we work within the field of knowledge, which I think is very important, because that makes very powerful. I think thinking on the school, I mean, the fact that several departments are really very much pressed or taking that seriously means that there are many, as you said, there are many different solutions that they can go in the same way and they can produce. I feel that that is the way I took a phrase from you that is, it means a certain difficulty, but at the same time, a certain optimism, which I think is what you, in your studio, you are trying to simulate. Thank you very much, Pedro.
Thank you. Okay.